If you have your Bibles, let's turn to the Galatians, the third chapter. If you've been around a church for any length of time, I don't care if you've been around church for 2 days, you've heard people say that, you've heard people talk about faith, the importance of faith. You got to have faith. You got to use faith. Got to believe. You got to this. You got to that. It's always about faith. But very, very few people, after saying that, teach you anything about faith. What is it? Where does it come from? How do you do it? How do you use it? My objective over the next few Sundays is to give you a step-by-step explanation of faith and its operations. If you take good notes, when we're done, you won't have to go and buy anything else to know how to use your faith, because you will know everything you need to know about faith, because I'm going to take my time and I'm going to teach it. Amen. All right? And I'm going to teach it from the aspect of we've never heard it before. All right. So I know we've taught on some things about faith over here for many, 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 many times as we're a faith church, but I want you to sit and listen today as if this was the first time you were ever being taught about the operation of faith. Now, Galatians chapter 3, I want you to look at verse 9. Verse 9 says, well, let's add 8 and 9 together. And the scriptures, foreseeing that God would justify or put in right standings with himself the heathens through faith. Now, I want you to pay attention to this. It said that God was going to put in right standing the heathens through their faith. Preach the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So we see here that there is a connection between the blessing and faith. All right? There is a connection between the blessing and faith. Verse 9, so then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. So they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. So without faith, you can't connect to the blessing. This is what I'm trying to get you to see. If I want to connect to the empowerment, faith is required. The Amplified Bible for that verse says that they that are of the same faith, we put it this way, they that use their faith the way Abraham used his faith have the same access to the blessing the way Abraham had access to the blessing. And if you go back and you look in the Word of God, the blessing made Abraham very wealthy, very strong in every aspect of his life. All right? So that means to me, and it would mean to you, that faith is important. Now, let's look at a few things here. Let's lay this out. Let's look at the book of Habakkuk. And if you don't know where Habakkuk is, consult your tables of contents. Habakkuk, chapter 2. Now, I'm going to read a series of scriptures. Starting in the Old Testament, we're going to come on up through the New Testament. Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 4. I'm going to read verse 3 with it. It says, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it shall surely come to pass, it will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. But notice this phrase. But the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. Habakkuk 2 and 4. Everybody got it? Let's look at Romans chapter 1. And in Romans chapter 1, verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. So now we've seen it twice. Let's look at 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Notice verse 7. It says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. That would be another way of saying that the just have to live how? By faith. Correct? Are y'all with me so far? All right, let's keep going. Galatians chapter 3, I believe. Give me a second, make sure I get to the right place. Oh. It's Galatians chapter 2. Verse 20, it says this, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lived in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. So that is another way of saying how? The just have to live how? By faith. All right? Galatians chapter 3, verse 11 says this, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, for it is evident the just shall live by faith. Hebrews chapter 10. And verse 38. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul has no pleasure in him. Those were multiple scriptures across the Bible, not just one, but across the Bible that says if you're going to live any other way, if you're going to live in the kingdom of God, there's only one way to do it, by faith. There is no other way for a child of God to succeed in the kingdom of God apart from faith. It is a requirement of kingdom living. The just must live by faith. Now, if we went through all of those scriptures across the Bible and we could find more, then that tells me that it would behoove every child of God to completely understand the operation of faith. Because if that's how I get things into my life, if that's how I plug and connect with the blessing, if that's how the scriptures require me to live in this kingdom, then you need to know how to do it. Yeah. It's not enough for us to tell you that you have to live by faith. You need to know how to take I need to live by faith and then walk it out and then see the manifestations of faith in your life. Amen. What good does it do to know that I need to live by faith and I don't even know how to operate it? You have people that have been saved for years, and they think that they're operating in faith, and they're not. The reason that a lot of God's people live in a life of defeat is because they don't understand how to work the law of faith. So my desire is to teach us how to work the operations of faith and hit the target every single time. All right? So we see Living by faith is a kingdom requirement. So then that would lead me to the next question. If I have to live by faith, if that is a requirement, why does the Word of God say I have to do? Why do we have to do it? It says you have to. Now, here's why. Number one, living by faith gets you out of the arena of the natural where Satan operates, and it takes you up into the arena of the supernatural and puts you above him. I'm going to give you word for all this. You will never defeat the devil in the natural because he has operating power there. This is why Jesus died and was raised from the dead. And the Bible says we were raised together and made to sit together with him in heavenly places. In other words, we were elevated above the natural. We're not limited to what goes on in the natural. We can take faith and affect the natural and change it. Now, let's look at this. I don't know what's going on with this microphone, but we need for it to get together. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to take my time. I'm not going to rush through this. I'm not going to rush at all. Amen. Here's why we need to live by faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 says, "In whom the God of this world," that is referring to Satan, "has blinded the mind of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." Notice, how is Satan able to blind anyone's mind? He's able to blind your mind when there's no faith involved. Because believing is a part of the faith operation. And it says he's blinded the mind of them that what? Believe not, the faithless. And that's important for you to understand. And you'll get it how the mind comes in here as we go through it, but where there is no faith, Satan can deceive you. That would be another way of putting blind the mind. You could be deceived. But here's how you get above that. Verse 18. "While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal." So I can take faith and get above Satan and not be deceived. And then it also says, here's how. Because I'm not paying attention to what I can see in the natural. I am being led and governed by my faith. And if I stick with faith, faith will change what I see in the natural. So here's why you have to live by faith, folks. It gets you above Satan. Satan has been locked in the natural arena. He can only deal with what you can see, feel, hear, taste, and touch. That's all Satan can deal with. But faith goes above that, and faith changes what you can see, feel, hear, taste, and touch. Example. Two words that I believe the devil purposely have caused to be intermingled so that it loses its essence of power. The two words would be facts and truth. They're not the same. You may go to the doctor and the doctor may say, "You have this problem." We see it on the x-ray, we see it in the blood test. It's there, it's a fact. A fact is a body of information that can be naturally proven. We see it. It's there. That is a fact. But that may not be the truth concerning you. Amen. I'm born again. I've been redeemed from the curse of the law, right? Did the Bible say that? Then what did Jesus say was one of the promises for a child of God? Isaiah 53, verse 5 says, by his stripes I am healed and made whole. That's the truth. So if I'll take my faith and plug into that truth and stay with it long enough, that truth will make me free from that fact. It'll change that thing. It was a fact that Lazarus had been dead for 3 days. His body had started to decay and older. But the truth was, Jesus is life. So the truth of who Jesus was changed the fact that he had been dead for 3 days. It don't matter. Faith doesn't care. All faith wants to know is, will you believe me and stick with me? That's what I'm trying to show you here. Faith, here's why we have to live by faith. Because if we don't, we are subject to the natural world with no hope and no way out. Now, let's look at Hebrews chapter 11. We're talking about reasons why we have to live by faith. Hebrews chapter 11 says this, verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. All right? Without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Without your faith, it's impossible to please God. Another word for please would be found acceptable. Without faith, God can't accept what you're trying to do. For he that comes to God, first of all, has to believe that God is who he said he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who won't quit. In other words, he that won't quit, faith will make manifest. It'll bring it to pass if you won't quit. So if I don't have any faith, then what I'm trying to do in the natural, God won't be able to back it. But if I'm using my faith, what I'm trying to do in the natural, I can be accepted by God and he will be able to back it. Why? Because it's based on faith. It's coming out of my faith. Now, I know I'm using this word a lot. I'm going to define it here in a minute. I'm just trying to get some ground rules established here. Number one, we know that we have to live by it because the Bible said it. Number two, now we see why. Are you tired of the devil beating up on you? Get out of his arena. Get out of his arena. You're not going to win fighting him in his arena. How do I do that? Elevate. Rise up on the wings of faith. Now, we know we have to live by faith. Now we see why we have to live by faith. So the next question we're going to answer is, where does one acquire this kind of faith? Now let me explain something here. Everybody in this room has faith. There are different types of faith. Amen. We're talking about God's kind of faith. We're talking about the God kind of faith right now. But then there's a natural faith. Everybody in here has one. I explained to you on last week, you open the refrigerator up, you expect the food to be cold. Why? Because you believe that refrigerator is working. That's faith. You sat down in a chair this morning, you didn't know whether or not we took the screws and stuff out. You flopped down on it, thinking it was gonna hold you up, right? That's a level of faith. You stuck that key in the ignition this morning, and like I said on last week, you sitting on a bomb. A gas tank full of gas, and it has to be, and igniters and all kind of stuff has to happen for that car to work. And you stick that key in there and turn the ignition on that thing, and don't even think about exploding, do you? Nope. Why? That's a level of faith. So we all operate in faith on a daily basis. We're talking about right now is operating in the God kind of faith. Your highest level of faith is the God faith. And you can operate in it the exact same way that you operate in anything else. The issue is Satan fights you when it comes to God's faith, but he don't fight you on anything else. Nobody had a struggle this morning with a fight and praying tongues and fast last night and praying tongues this morning to start your car, did you? Satan, he ain't fighting you on that. Did nobody have to fight and call for a prayer meeting to make sure that when you hit your thermostat this morning and you turned it from 60 to 70 that it was going to work? You just automatically assumed it was going to work if you paid the bill. The natural faith he doesn't fight you over. It's when you get ready to try to elevate into the realm of the Spirit and use God's faith. Now he want to battle you now. Why? Because if you ever develop in God's faith, you get above him. And you can tell him what to do instead of him continuously telling you what to do. So where does one acquire this kind of faith? Well, first of all, look at Mark chapter 11. Where does it come from? Because you know you had some people in the Bible thought they could pay for it. They could buy it. And you got some folks these days that think they can buy it. You can't buy this. Mark chapter 11 and verse 22. Jesus said this, and Jesus answering and said unto them, have faith in God. Now, I don't know if your Bible set up like my Bible, but I have a little letter there that's a cross-reference for the Greek. And when you read it the way that it's originally written, it says this, have the God kind of faith. So in other words, have God's faith. So where does this kind of faith come from? It comes from God. Without God, you can't get it. All right? This is not something you go to school to learn. It came from God. All right? This is why you have to be born again to operate in this level of faith. If you're not born again, you can't operate in this level of faith. There is no mechanism on the inside of you for it to flow through. All right? Just like right now, there are all kind of words floating through this room. Thousands of words are flowing through this room. But without a mechanism, we can't capture them. But if we will plug something in and tune with an antenna and tune it to the right frequency, we can begin to snatch those words out of the air. Same thing is true with God's kind of faith. Without the mechanisms on the inside of you, you can't plug in and access this kind of faith. But if you're born again, you have been built and the mechanism is in there. Came in with a new birth. So we see that this kind of faith comes from God. What does St. John chapter 1, verse 1 say? In the beginning was what? The Word. And the Word was God. And the Word was with God. And the same was in the beginning with God. And then verse 14 says, and the Word that was in the beginning, that was God, that was with God, and the Word became flesh and dwelled among us. In the person of Jesus, right? Now, let's take that and take that over to Romans chapter 10. I'm telling you now, you come over here, you better have a Bible and a pen and a pad, because I'm going to walk you step by step through this thing. And I'm telling you, when you get through, if you take good notes when you get through, you'll be able to explain faith to anybody, anywhere, at any time, and you will have there will be no confusion about it. And you'll have it's going to be based on the Word, not somebody's opinion. Because there's a thousand opinions out there what faith is all about, but that doesn't mean it's right. I want to know, what did the Bible say about it? What did God say? Because if I can get it from him, now I know I got it. So we know the Word was with God, and the Word is God, and the Word became flesh. Notice what it says here in Romans 10, verse 17. So then faith, it comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So faith comes from God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So without God's Word, which equals God, I don't have any faith. This is why the Bible says without faith it's impossible to please God. You can't please Him without His Word. If I tell you, how could I put this? If I'm going to send Brother Moya here to my bank to withdraw money out of my account, he has to have some type of an authorization. The bank's not going to accept anything less than my word, right? How do I give him my word? It's called a check with my signature. And as long as the check has a proper signature on it, he can take that check, go to the bank, and it's acceptable. They're giving whatever the check says giving. Well, God has given you a check. And his name's been signed on it. And it's been signed in the blood. All he's asking for you to, and matter of fact, it's a blank check. All he asks you to do is fill in what you need, and I'll back it. So, but now notice, fill in what you need has to come from where? The Word. So I got to get into the Word, find scripture that delivers me from my problem, which is going to become my faith, my authorization, and he'll back it. But if you won't get, see, if you're trying to do something based on how you feel and how you think, he's not backing that because it didn't come out of his word. Can't do that. That's why it says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. No, it didn't say faith came because you heard something. You got some people think I heard it once, oh, I got it and gone. No, you don't. You're getting ready to go down there and have a shipwreck. Hearing is a continuation word. Do you continually hear it? Continually feed on it? Continually meditate on it? Because there's a development in your faith as well. We haven't gotten to it yet, but it has to be developed. To this morning, you're hearing the word concerning faith. But if you don't do something with what you're hearing, it still doesn't benefit you because it's not developed. I want you to hear this morning. Faith does not come from problems. You got some people to think, well, you know, you got all these trials going on. It just makes your faith stronger. No, it doesn't. If problems made you a faith giant, then everybody in the church would be faith giants because everybody got problems. Problems are the equivalent of the treadmill and the weight bench. Just because I have a treadmill and a weight bench in my basement doesn't necessarily mean I'm going to become physically strong. Does it? No. It's what I do with the treadmill and the weight bench that yields the benefit. Just because you know a scripture don't mean a thing. It's based on what are you going to do with what you know. Because when you start meditating and operating in what you know, that develops your faith, not the problem. I'm not basing nothing on a problem. Faith will get rid of a problem, but the problem is not going to make my faith strong. It's what will I do with the Word of God in the midst of the problem. Now you're talking about the development of your faith. All right? So it's no faith comes from God. Everybody in this room, let me see the hands of everybody that's born again. You have accepted Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. Then, according to Romans chapter 12, verse 3, you have faith. God put it in you. Romans chapter 12, verse 3 says that God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Every person that is born into the kingdom of God, you are birthed with that measure of faith, God's measure. He puts it in there. It's in you now. Now, it may not be developed, but it's there. God's faith is in you because He put it in you. When He moved in, His faith came in with Him. In every baby born, every single baby born, the potential of a fully developed, grown human adult already exists in that baby, although we don't see it yet, but it's there. Amen. The ability for a baby to produce another human being is present in that baby when it's born. It's there. But everything has to be developed. Same thing is true when you were birthed into the kingdom of God. The potential to walk in this earth and operate the same way on the same level Jesus did exists on the inside of each and every one of us now. Same potential. Same potential. If you and I were have developed our faith to the point that Jesus has, we could have did the exact same thing at the tomb of Lazarus that Jesus did. It didn't happen because He was special. It happened because He would use His faith and He knew how, because He developed it. Can be done, folks. But I know that that's way out there. But see, if you're fighting that thought, that is a sign right there that your mind and your faith level hasn't been developed to its maximum degree yet. Because the stronger you develop your faith, the greater the capacity to believe. The greater the capacity to believe, the more intense the blessing goes to work in your life. It can do more now. Same thing is true when you start working out with those weights. You don't lost your mind. You have never lifted weights before in your life, and you're going to go in there, and I'm going to go bench me 100 pounds. You can hurt yourself. Most of you couldn't even lift a bar without any weights on it 4 or 5 times. And you're talking about 100 pounds on top of the bar? You can hurt yourself. But if I'll take the bar, work out for a few months, oh, now I can add maybe 10 on that side and 10 on that side and work out for a few months. I can bump on up to 40 now, work out for a few months. But eventually, I can lift that 100 pounds. But I had to do what? Develop. Same thing with your faith, folks. It will grow, it will grow, it will develop, and it will move mountains. But it has to be developed to that point. All right, let's keep going. Let's keep going. Got a few more minutes here. All right. Hope this is helping you. Hebrews chapter 8. We're talking about you have the faith of God right now. It came in with the new birth. Because God dealt to every man the measure of faith. That's what He says. He says, I have dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now look at Hebrews. Let me show you how it's done. Now, how does faith come? It says it comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So faith comes through the word. Let me give you a definition for it real quick here. Faith would be the amount of word you know, believe, and act on. That's your personal faith level. It is the amount of word you know, believe, and acting on. That is your personal faith level. In other words, everybody in this room, you're operating in faith, but it's on a different, it may be on various levels. Just depends on how much of this word do you know. See, why do people go to church? People go to church for all different reasons. It's the right thing to do. It's Sunday. They swung from the rafters and kept me stirred up and it kept my flesh engaged. That ain't really the reason you go. It's good. But you come to church to learn how to win. You come to church that the word can be preached to you so that you can get something to go home and meditate upon and develop in and grow in so that you can act on it and win. Amen. That's why you're here. Faith is the amount of word you know, believe, and act on. Now, Hebrews chapter 8 says this. Verse 10. For this is the covenant that I will make with them, or this is the promise that I will make with them, or that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, rather, says the Lord. Now notice this. I will put my law in their mind and write them upon their heart, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. Now, take out the word law there and exchange it for the word of God. And let's read it like it would read this way. I will put my word in their minds, and I will write my word upon their heart. Well, when did he write anything on your heart? When did he put anything in you? Because he says here, hey, I'm going to put my word in their minds, and I'm going to write my word on their hearts. That's what he just said there, right? And we know that faith has to do with the amount of word that you have. And I'm trying to show you here that you already have it because God has written it in your heart. Your spirit, well, let me read this scripture, then I'll say that. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And then I'll make this statement and it'll be clear. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22. Well, verse 21 with it, it says, now he which established us with you is Christ and has anointed us. He which establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us is God who has sealed us and given us the earnest of his spirit in our hearts. When you got born again, God's spirit came in. And your spirit and God's spirit were united. The moment that happened, the moment that took place, God is the Word. And the Word was now written upon your heart. In other words, you can look at it this way. Your spirit does not fight God. It's your unrenewed mind. Your spirit loves the things of God. Your spirit man understands God. Your spirit man flows with God. Why? Because the Bible says that they've been joined and have become one. They are in perfect alignment, perfect agreement. The issue is when God speaks something to your spirit and your spirit sends it up to your mind, if your mind is not renewed, your mind says that's dumb and discards it. But if it wasn't already in there, it couldn't come up. Yeah. That's what I'm trying to get you to see. The reason the answer when you pray can come up to your mind is because it's already in there. If it wasn't in there, you couldn't get anything to come out. Now, what God needs for you to do is renew that mind, allow him to write his word upon your mind. Well, how does he do that, Pastor? Well, go look at Hebrews, I believe it is. And let's prove James. James. Let's go to James. Let me show you how this happens. I told you I'm walking you through this thing step by step this morning. James chapter 1. Now we've already seen how he's written it upon your heart. But notice what it says here in James chapter 1. Let me read verse 21 from the Amplified Bible for you. It says, so get rid of all uncleanliness and rapid outgrowth of wickedness, and in a humble, generous, modest spirit, receive and welcome the word which implanted and rooted in your heart. That's your spirit. Knows it contains the power to save your soul. So the word that God has written in your heart, if you will let it come up, if you will welcome it, if you'll meditate it, if you'll use it, if you'll get involved with it, it contains the power to save your soul. It's dealing with your mind. It'll renew your mind so that when your spirit sends the answer up, your mind says, yes, we believe that. We'll take that and we'll do that. But when your mind is unrenewed, your spirit sends the answer up. Your mind says, that doesn't make sense. That's dumb. I ain't doing that. And you throw it away. And you stay stuck where you are. Because you didn't let your faith engage. All right? So we all have faith. Came in with a new birth. Now, we're going to end here with this today. I must have set this clock for something weird, or it's not working right. But we're going to end here with this today. We know to live in the kingdom, we have to have faith. I've explained to you why we need to live by faith. Now you know where it comes from. It comes from God, and you already have it. Now, let's look at your faith has to grow and be developed. I want to prove that to you. Faith has to grow, and it needs to be developed. And if you're not going to develop your faith, although you have it, you still won't win at the game of life because you won't know how to use it. You can take a .38 revolver fully loaded and lay it on the table and put a one-year-old in the room. Now, although there's a loaded .38 revolver on the table, there's a one-year-old in the room, and the one-year-old in the room is getting ready to be murdered by some crazy lunatic. There is protection on the table, but the one-year-old doesn't know how to use it. So they're vulnerable, right? That is the exact same thing with an immature Christian. You have a loaded gun called faith, but you're immature, and you're being violated and don't know how to use it. And it shouldn't be. Shouldn't be. And what's even worse is that some of us has been around the church for a long, well, some of, I won't say us, some of you have been around the church for a long time and should know how to use your faith so that a one-year-old new Christian can come run to you when they need help and they can't because both of y'all getting ready to get violated because you don't know what to do and you can't help him when you should have been the one saying, wait, just one second. Come on in here and come on behind here. Now, devil, I know how to use this .38 now. Now, you want to come on over here? I know what I'm doing with my faith, and you can back that devil up off of them. But if you don't know how to use it and they don't know how to use it, you're both in trouble. This is why we have to develop, folks. This is why, if you notice, churches are supposed to operate like this. You have babies that come in. They're supposed to grow up and move on out the way. What do you mean moving out the way? They should come in, start learning how to use their faith, and now they can stand up on their own, moving out the way. Why? Because now we're going to make room for the next babies to come on in. But if everybody stay a baby in the church, everybody in trouble. Because there's nobody to assist. Now, Luke 11. We're almost done here. Luke chapter 11. I'll take that back. Let's go to Luke 17. Luke 17. Now, listen to the question that the disciples, the apostles rather, disciples, apostles, listen to what they asked Jesus. Verse 5. And the apostles said unto the Lord, increase our faith. So they wanted their faith to be increased. Notice Jesus' response to the question. See, because if you don't pay attention to the question, you don't understand the answer he gave. The question is, we want our faith to increase. Increase this. How do we increase our faith? Jesus' answer, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say unto the sycamine tree, be plucked up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Yeah. Now, what did Jesus just say? They asked to get their faith increased. Jesus said what? If you have faith as a seed, what do you do with a seed? You plant it. What is another word for plant? Develop. You got to develop that thing, cultivate that thing. Jesus just told them, you want your faith to grow? Sow it, develop it. How do I sow and develop my faith? Meditating it and using it. The more you meditate on it, the more you practice it, the more it develops. Just having faith as a seed is not going to move a tree. But if it grows and develops and becomes strong, it'll blast a mountain down, is what he's trying to get you to see here. But you're going to have to develop it. Faith has to be developed. 2 Thessalonians. Chapter 1. Verse 3. We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly. Your faith groweth exceedingly. Notice, faith can grow. Or it can be developed again. It should be being always in the process of being developed. You should be a little stronger this year than you were last year when it comes to your faith. And then next year, you should be stronger than you are right now when it comes to your faith. If you've been around a church for X amount of years and everything is still status quo, the same way it was when you got saved, then something's wrong. It was never designed to work that way. It should be getting better and better every single year. You should be increasing. If it's not, you're not doing it right. Now, 1 Peter tells you how you develop your faith. Where does it start? Where does faith development, where does it start? 2 Peter. Let me find it. Give me a second. Where are we going? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. Talking to baby saints. As newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that they may grow thereby. In other words, when you come in here, the job of the pastor for a new baby saint is to take the word of God and feed it to you as milk. Repeat it over and over and over again. Take time, be patient. Answer questions if questions need to be answered. Do what I'm doing this morning. Hey, folks, what good would it do? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not against pastors that like to hoop and holler. I am not against them. We need them in the body of Christ. But if all you got was a hoop and a holler and a shake and a jiggle, and you went back out and on Monday morning when Satan knocked on your door, the hoop, the holler, the shake, and the jiggle is not going to help you. You can say what you want to say. I came out, we came out of a Pentecostal church, and we knew how to shake, jiggle, run, buck, and holler. Did it every Sunday. But on Monday, didn't know how to win. So by Wednesday, your shake, jiggle, and holler is all used up. So you become a spiritual junkie, going from Sunday to Wednesday to get another fix so that you can make it a few more days. And that is not how we're supposed to live Christianity. We're supposed to be winning every day. When the devil show up and knock on your door, you ought to be like, excuse me, you got the wrong house. And let me show you why. Matter of fact, it ought to be like this. He ought not want to knock on your door. I heard a story of Kenneth Hagin was given. God showed it to him in a vision, I think it was. He said he saw these devils walking down the street in a neighborhood. And they were little devils that were under control of the bigger devils. Yeah. The little devils were in training. And he says they walked down the street. The bigger devil said, now, you little devils, y'all go in that house over there, and I want you to go over and torment them in that house, and y'all go get these over in that house. And then there's these one little demons, we want to go in that house, And the big devil says, nah, y'all don't want to go in that house over there. That old lady in there will take the word and beat your brains out. Y'all ain't ready for her. That's how it'll be when they come to your house. No, we don't want to go in there. But most of God's people are floor mats when it comes to the devil because they don't know what we're talking about this morning. They quit. Wave the white flag before the fight even start. Wake up in the morning with a slight chill. Oh, I think I'm getting the flu. It was just a slight chill. How did it go away to the flu? Don't wave the white flag just that quick. The devil said, well, we think you might have. Before you leave, before you can make it from the doctor's clinic back to your house, you don't call four people and say, girl, the doctor says I got. That ain't what the doctor said. Yeah. Waving the right flag. Why? Because you don't know this. Hebrews chapter 12. I'm just taking you step by step through the word because we need to know. This is why you're not winning, folks. And we're plugging in this year. We're connecting with this blessing this year. We're winning this year. No more losing. No more conceding to the devil. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. How do you develop your faith? Looking unto Jesus. The Amplified Bible says, looking away from all that is distracting to Jesus, who is the leader and source of your faith. Looking away from everything that's going to distract you and looking to Jesus. How do I look to Jesus? I've already told you how to do that. It's found in St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh in the person of Jesus. So if I'm going to, in 2017, if I'm going to look to Jesus, I'm going to crack open this book, and I'm looking at Jesus. Looking away from everything that's distracting to this book, this Word, which is the source. It is where your faith starts, and it is the finisher. It is where your faith ends. Every victory starts and ends with the Word of God. Looking away from all the distractions to Jesus, who is the leader, the source of your faith. Verse 3. For consider him that endures such contradiction of sinners against him, lest you be weary and faint in your mind. Now let's put these two things together, because I want you to see something here. When things are connected by commas and semicolons and everything, it's just connections and carry-ons of a thought. So that means we could move things around and it would still have the same meaning. So let's just look at it this way. Looking unto Jesus, the author or the source and finisher of your faith, and let's take the last half of verse 3. Lest you be weary and faint in your mind. The Amplified Bible says, so that you may not grow weary and exhausted and lose heart and relax and faint in your mind. That's what the devil wants to do. Folks who don't know how to use their faith become exhausted. Why? Because you've been trying to fight that thing in the natural. And Satan understands, if I can keep you fighting in the natural, I will eventually wear you out. Amen. And you will quit. But when I shift gears on him and go into the spirit by faith, it's no longer me fighting the battle now. You dealing with this word now, buddy. And it never runs out. It never becomes exhausted. It will stand until the end. And all I have to do is do what the Word of God says, hide behind the shield of faith and fire away, devil, because every dart you shoot is not getting to me. Why? Because my word will stand, is what God said. Amen. Remember, he said the shield of faith will quench all the fiery darts of the devil? And fiery darts are those thoughts that are hitting your mind when your shield is down. But if you ever go back and look at Roman days, they would take their shields, which were made out of leather, this, you know, leather wrapped on top of leather, wrapped on top of leather. They would take those leather shields and saturate them in water. Saturate them in water till they're just dripping with water. And the shields were huge. You know, the shield was about this tall. They could scroll down behind them. And when because the enemy would take darts, their arrows, and light them on fire, and they would shoot them at them. Back in the Roman days. Well, if I had a shield, which was this tall, and it's wet, and all I had to do was hide behind it, every time a fiery arrow hit it, the water's going to do what to the dart? Put it out. That's what faith does. When the devil come and tell you it's not going to work, faith puts it out. Shut up, devil. It's already working. You're never going to get healed. What are you talking about? I'm not going to get healed. Dumb, did you read the word? It says, by his stripes, I'm already healed. I'm not trying to get, I'm already. Amen. See, faith talks a certain way. We're going to get there. Faith talks a certain way. Amen. And to a natural ear, it sounds crazy. But to someone to know what you're doing, oh, okay, that's a faith person right there. Its speech patterns are, hey, I like to call it the vocabulary of the kingdom of God. It is completely different than what you hear every day in the world. This is why I say, hey, I don't care about you telling me how long you've been in church. All I need to do is just let me just hear you talk for a while. Now, in closing, I'll give you an example of this. Let's take Peter. At the beginning of Jesus and Peter's relationship, the story picks it up and Peter's out fishing, right? No, he had just come home from fishing. He's cleaning his nets. Jesus asked Peter, can I use your boat to preach? So Peter says, okay, I'll push out a little bit, and while I'm cleaning my nets, go ahead and use my boat and preach. So that means in proximity, he's close enough to hear what Jesus is preaching. Jesus is preaching the kingdom. He's preaching the blessing. That's what he said he came to do. So although Peter may not be directly listening, he's overhearing what's being preached, right? So now Jesus through preaching. All right, Peter, launch out into the deep. We're getting ready to cast some fish. Now notice that Peter really truly, that this is their first, we're just engaging here. Peter's like, well, nah, man, that ain't gonna work. What's happening here? See, his mind is battling the words that he's hearing because he knows about fishing. He's a fisherman. That's what he does for a living. And he knows you cannot fish on the Galilean Sea in the daytime. You got to fish at night. He knows that. But Jesus is saying, we're going fishing in the daytime. He's trying to tell Jesus, it don't work, bro. But Jesus is trying to tell him, hey, whoa, I know, I got this. The blessing's working with you. I know what I'm doing. Will you obey? So Peter finally says, all right, nevertheless, we'll go. Now, notice, his faith is working to a small degree here because he went on and went. He could have said, man, I ain't going nowhere. God, I get off my boat. I'm done with that. And went on. But he didn't do that, did he? So the faith was working, but it's working very, 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 very scarcely here. And I want you to watch this. Got out there. Jesus said, and cast your nets, plural. When you read the story, it says, and Peter cast the net, one. And when you read the references, he cast the rotten one that was no good. That's why it broke. Do you think a fisherman who was a career fisherman nets would break unless they're using the bad ones. He knows which one he threw out there. I just got to spend all the time cleaning my good ones. I'm not getting ready to have to do this again. Throw that old raggedy one in the corner. Throw that out there. And so they threw it out there. And what did Jesus say was going to happen? Every fish in the Sea of Galilee gathered up in that net and it started breaking. He had to call partners and everybody came. Finally, they filled all the boats up with fish. And the Bible says Peter fell down at Jesus' feet and said, "Forgive me." First interactions, relationships. First development of faith. Now, let's walk a few miles with Jesus, learn a few things, grow a little bit. All right, now we're down here. We don't spend some time with the man now. We don't see what he can do. So now we're down here. Hey, don't your master pay taxes? Asking Jesus a question. Asking Peter a question. And Jesus is like, "Well, yeah, we pay taxes." Well, it's time to, I need my tax money. So what did the Bible say Peter did? The Bible said Peter did what? Went to the house and said, "Jesus, we got to pay taxes." Jesus didn't say, "Well, go on down to the treasury and get it," did he? What did he say do? Go fishing. This time, no hesitation. Go, "Oh, really? Oh, yeah, let's go fishing." Now, notice the first time he said, "Let's go fishing," hesitation. Second time, the faith's developed, faith's developed, faith developed. Let's go fishing. This time, no hesitation. Why? Because I've spent enough time with the man to know that if he say we're going to fish and we're going to get something, I like a hook, here we go. See the development? First time, struggle. Second time, hey. And the second time was harder to believe than the first time. The first time says, "Put your net in and let's catch some fish." Okay, it's daytime, but I can see a net catching some fish. The second time you say, the first fish you pull up, get the money out of the fish's mouth and go pay the taxes. Anybody with common sense will tell you, a fish cannot survive with its mouth plugged up. That's how it breathes in the water. So you mean to tell me that if I'm going to find a fish is going to swim already with a full mouth of money and bite my net? Am I my hook too? Oh, well, yeah, sure. Okay, let's go get him. It was hard to believe the second time than it would have been the first time, but it was easier for him to do it the second time than the first time. Why? Faith had developed. Yeah. I'm trying to show you something here. I'm trying to make this as simple as I can. You can grow your faith and you can believe the unbelievable. Although it may be unbelievable to them, it doesn't have to be unbelievable to you. If you can believe it, you can achieve it. Don't mean everybody else can. They might not be able to, but I can. Some people may not believe that they can be delivered from an incurable disease. Those that have developed their faith can. Some people may not believe that I'm able to pay off a 30-year mortgage in a year. I believe it, and I'm going to do it. You don't have to. That's all right. Keep paying on you for your 30 years if that's what you want to do. And guess what? Jesus will help you every year, all 30 of them. He will. But I'd rather go ahead and get all the help at the front and be done and move on because I don't want to be in debt. It's up to what you'll believe, folks. It's up to how you'll use your faith. So that's just the foundation now. You know you have to have faith. You know why you have to have faith. You know where it comes from, and you can see it needs to be developed. Next Sunday, we'll go on for phase two. All right? Father, we thank you this morning for your word, the simplicity of it. And Holy Spirit, I'm asking that you would partner with me and help me teach this thing line up on line, step by step, so that when we're done with it, there is no question about how to win at life, how to connect and plug into this blessing. We give you praise for that this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.